didn't show up with her because I admired her work for a long time. We're having a great time in Boston and in Byron, and I am going to show work. And I have to say that when you reach my age, you've done a lot of different kinds of work. It's really hard. It's just like having children. It's really hard. You don't want to ignore any of them. So I'm going to show lots of work from a long period of time. And it just accumulates. So I'm going to try to go fast. So if you have questions, you can interrupt me or you can save them up for later. And I even have my crib sheet because I was fed so well today that I don't know if my brain is working. So I'm just going to keep this up. I am going to say that I'm going to show a variety of approaches and techniques, and the slideshow is organized by like form or idea rather than by date. So here we go. So I wanted to say that I'm very influenced by. I'm lucky that I got to move to Montana because it's a wide open space. There's less than a million people in the third largest state in the country. And so you have room to experiment. That's one thing that's really important. Maybe you don't feel like there's a lot of competition. You can just sort of develop your own thing a little bit more on your own. And then also the inspiration of the land. I've never felt like I've had a relationship with land before, but I do. And I feel really lucky to live there. The other Montana influence is the number of ceramic artists there, the Pete Polkus and Rudy Audio and the Archie Gray Foundation. This is Rudy Audio, who was my professor, who taught in a way that he left me alone a lot and just taught by example. And one of the examples or things that he taught me is to draw on the surfaces of form. Some of you who know Rudy Audio's work will also notice that he does this little red cheek mark on his pieces, and I just completely stole that. So when you see some of my pieces, you'll see that even on this piece. I started out throwing pots, just like many people who get engaged in ceramics because they love the wheel. It's just something that is the most mind-consuming, making you feel very present when you're working in clay. And so I started out, I became beguiled by porcelain because of its wonderful texture and whiteness. And I just started making sort of simple, traditional forms. But one day I started shows kids, it shows everybody as healthy and positive and helping the revolution and being completely loyal, and they're all the same. So it sort of struck me as, okay, that's some kind of ideal that especially immigrant parents have of this is, we're gonna have these kids go forward and be really strong and brave and perfect. And yeah, we know it's not realistic, but you still have these ideas of how do you raise a good child. So the whole series of these good children started from that, those feelings of how do you raise, what is good, and how do you raise a child to be good. So I started making images of little kids doing very precocious things, or doing things that are beyond what a child of that age could do. This is one of a series in that series of Good Children Platters, and this one is called, these two, this one and the next one are called Work and Play. And my thought with that is that what you want is you want their work to be their play, and their play to be their work, and that's how you get, how you reach satisfaction and art and creativity. So just the idea that one person might consider what they're doing work and another person might consider it play. So those are the word for work and play in Chinese. And this is the same kind of thing. Somebody's baking and one person says, this is too much work, and the other one's cooking. These figures became three-dimensional after a while. These are good children teapots. Their heads come out. Their water can come, tea can come out of their fingers. Just these are salt and pepper shakers. So sometimes you just take a form and try different things with it. These, the last two were slip cast. I'm going fast, so I hope that's okay, because I just have a lot of stuff to go through. So this is influences. One of the influences is Frida Kahlo. I don't know if everybody's sick of her.
No.
But she's incredible. And the things that, when I saw her work, and I just related to it immediately in a little tiny photo in the back of art form. And the things that she gave me, artists give each other things because they do something and then you go, oh yeah, I can do that too. So she did self-portraiture, or work that was about herself. She did work about her ethnicity, and she did work about psychological pain, and her work sort of was evidence to that idea that the personal is political, which is a 1970s feminist mantra, really, that what happens to you as a person has ramifications in a wider world that is personal, that is political. So she's important. In terms of the ethnicity, as soon as I did have my child, and as a result looked at my parents in a whole different way and thought about their story as immigrants, I started to think about what did I want to pass on that was Chinese to Thai, and what did I have, what struggles did I have with being Chinese, a minority in a predominantly white culture, and what were my relationships with my culture. So this is a piece of five figures. They're all small, about 8 or 10 inches tall. called Harmony and Anthem. I made this piece when Obama was being elected and he was being criticized for not wearing a lapel pin. And I just thought about what is patriotism and how you represent your culture. And, so the little boy with the electric guitar is patriotic to the U.S. and the little girl has a mouth button and has an acoustic guitar. And I thought that Harmony was a more Asian sounding word and Anthem was a more aggressively patriotic sounding word. And then these are the two pieces in the show here. So I do a lot with boys and girls just to sort of contrast the two and talk about what is it to be a little boy and what is it to be a little girl. And they both have the Chinese, sort of typical Chinese painting landscape on the bottom, and then there's a very rough calligraphy of the word for boy and the word for girl on them. And these pieces have more of a sort of a graffiti feel and a little looser and approach. Another influence are sort of kitsch and slip cast mold ceramics, ceramics from high culture and ceramics from low culture. And these are two racist pieces of ceramics culture. And one of the things, maybe Kyungmin agrees with me or not, but it's how is it acceptable to make a racist joke? And it seems to be like some of the people here are from Chinese family camp, and we used to sit around and have joke time. And sometimes there'd be racist jokes, or we would speak in fake Chinese accents. And it's okay. It seems to be okay if you make a racist joke with you when you're within the race. So at this point, I will tell my famous racist joke, which is, I'll tell the one, how do you know if a Chinese robber has been in your house?
How?
Your dog is missing and your math homework is done. I'll tell another one if we have time. And then cartoons, just the format of cartoons is what I grew up with. I was a big comic book fan. So the speech bubble and Lulu is like the best girl role model of all the comics of the 50s. And she was really smart and tough and held her own. So I started making a lot of these pieces with slip cast speech bubbles. That it's a great format for you to add content to your work if you have somebody saying something. So this is a piece about how most products are made in China and that whole phrase of made in China. This is called made in the USA. This piece is called All of Same. And the word same is repeated in four languages, Korean, Japanese, Chinese, and English. And it comes from a website called allofsame.com where they show faces and you have to score and see if you can identify which nationality they're from. So my son, I told you I'm really bad at it. So
yeah.
I scored less than 25%, which means less than random. So if I had just scored A on all of them, I would have gotten them. this says, I am an American person, and you can see that this little yellow figure is being slowly sunken into the red, white, and blue, the stars and stripes. So it's that question of nature and nurture. This piece on the left is in the show. It's ABC. And the character for Wo, which is I. So I am an ABC. It's the ABC is what we used to call American-born Chinese. And I also feel like it's nice because if you think about a child's room or something, you could just have the ABC up there and have it be about the basics. The piece on the right is called potential, which is like, what is the future? What, how can you form it? How can you help? Or what will they become? Vulnerability, that sense of things can happen. This child may need protection and play. So those are the four characteristics of the child that I think are make the child a wonderful symbol to use in my work. Another influence is calligraphy. This is the work by Xu Bing, who is a wonderful Chinese contemporary artist, and he does a lot of things that sort of parody or take off of important things in Chinese culture. And this is calligraphy. It's all fake. None of these words are real. It just looks like calligraphy. And he's done huge installations with this calligraphy. But it's an understanding that calligraphy is so important as a discipline and an aesthetic thing in Chinese culture. So the next few slides are just other aspects of Chinese culture that I said, okay, I can borrow from this in my work. So this spells out jiating. This is slip cast bamboo on which I wrote sayings of do's and don'ts that you would teach a child. And this is slip cast from the bamboo in Jeannie's sister's garden. Origami and mahjong are also things that are really important in my family, so I was able to just use these just as imagery and reference. These are porcelain objects that are carved out of solid clay, but they're painted to look like they're folded out of funerary paper, and I'm going to talk about funerary paper some more later, but these are like, this would be money, this would be the form of money that you would burn at somebody's death. And then the Buddhist hand, or the mudras, is another Asian thing. These are some large sheetrock pieces these are like about 5 feet tall. These are done quite a while ago, but they have a lot of the elements that I have used in some of the other work. So mahjong and sort of fake calligraphy and chops, which are the stamps, and identity with the fingerprints. And I like the sheetrock because it's a really receptive material to draw on with ink. You can work sort of with brush painting style. You can also make marks by pounding stuff into the sheetrock. And when you can still buy the nails and stuff by the each, like you can across the street in the hardware store, you can buy really interesting variety of nails and things that refer to the sheetrock as a building material, but also can act as marks and mark making. So those are just some large pieces that have sort of the content and the brush painting work. The brown on these pieces are me taking a sponge and rubbing away the top layer of the sheetrock paper and getting down to the brown cardboard material inside. Back to the socialist realist work. So this is another piece that's in Tiananmen Square, and it has that heroic and realism imagery that I've also been interested in. So this is a piece called Legal Aliens, which are slip cast versions of my parents who were legal as citizens, but they were still considered aliens in the United States and ran across certain kinds of prejudice. So again, looking towards my family, my parents' family, my mother's family has an amazing bunch of relatives. So we have visited China about 5 times. And when we go, they come out in droves. And like the first dinner party that they had, there was 60 people that came to the dinner party. And they love to take pictures. And so you go and you take the pictures in all combinations. It's not like they're shy. They're not camera shy. You hold the camera up, the Chinese flock. So they take pictures. concrete buildings with very little furniture, and they gave my brother-in-law their cameras that they had for a long time. They gave us their mouse buttons. They didn't have anything, but they gave it to us. And what we did a lot of the time was look through old photo albums. So I've done a series of images from the photo albums. This is just called Family Album Series. This is the family lined up in front of their new house. This is the Ladies of Bombay, which is commemorating when my mother immigrated to the United States and had to spend several months in Bombay waiting for a neutral ship to bring them to the United States, to New York. And it's done to look like a socialist realist plaque or monument. This is interesting. These are my cousins, and they live in England now. But when they got married, you know, you couldn't have religion in communist China. So to get married, the only thing that they could do is exchange their mao buttons. That was their ceremony. So like I said, they only had mao buttons. So a lot of what I started thinking after I did all these works, like I said, I showed some of them to them, and I think it embarrassed them. And I thought, well, us, we artists, we always feel like we're doing stuff for others and to give to the world. But a lot of what we do is to take, I'm taking their story, I'm using their image. And I started thinking, there's another way to do this. How can I give back in some way? So I started thinking in a very small way, what I can do is collaborate so that I can share love of art with my friends and relatives. And so in particular, my mother has always done Chinese painting on her own. And so we started collaborating on artwork. So this is my mother painting in my studio. Having a good time. This is one of her paintings. But she always just painted for herself, and she never showed her work at all. So we did all these collaborative porcelain pieces with some of her painting on it, and she said, oh, I'm like Grandma Moses. And she also, when I had this piece went to Taiwan to a show, and it came out with a book, and she was just so excited. So we've had about 4 shows together with collaborative work, her work and my work. And as she's aged, Jeannie and I have both got organized art shows for her. And just recently for her memorial, Jeannie organized a beautiful art show at the University of Oregon International Center, and we showed a lot of her paintings. So the other collaboration is with Jeannie, my sister, who's in the front row here. And so she wrote, we always wanted to do children's books because our childhood was so wonderful. So she wrote the text and I did the illustrations on ceramics. So this is much on All Day Long and some interior shots. And this is Auntie Young's Great Soybean Picnic. And there's a couple copies of that book here and some interior shots. And so this finding of soybeans in Illinois for our parents was a really important cultural thing for them. And so I started to do some work about food. And this piece also has a little bit of a political edge. It's about, there's a plate with none, and there's a plate with one, and there's a plate with two on it to 25. And it's basically about those who have and those who don't have. And then these pieces, which are like the ones on the wall, are, or maybe they are the ones on the wall. If they're different. But they're about foods that Americans have shared with Chinese people. And I call these pieces language lessons, because if you were going to learn how to speak Chinese, like the word for salad is shala, and the word for pizza is biza. I just think that's funny. So if you're trying So I started using the Celadon as an image for water. So I'm going to run through some quick pieces to show you how I use the Celadon to look like water. And water for me is a little bit unrelated to some of the other ideas, but I like water because it's got so much type of symbolism. It can be both positive and life-giving, but it can also be life-taking and dangerous. So this is a piece where it's more dangerous. These are babies that are stuck in buckets, and the piece is really about isolation. This can be read as broken line, straight line, broken line, broken line, straight line, broken line, which is the water hexagram in the I Ching. Oops, this is just a piece called One Way. These little swimmers, and then these swimmer cups. And then these I call dip bowls. So the bowls are drawn as if their feet, the kids are sitting on the ledge and their feet are dipped into the water. And then the last series I have here are pieces that are based off of funerary ideas. So as my sister Jeannie and I took care of my mom, a lot of things occurred to us about our own mortality of my mom, what we are inheriting from her, and what we are passing on to our kids. So the funerary and end-of-life issues really became thought-provoking. So a lot of these images come from funerary papers, which are the papers that you burn. You can buy them in Chinatown. They're great printmaking. They're cheap. You can get really great imagery for $3.95, $3.95. So using these same images on those some of the bases that you see here. And then these are some of the export bases where you can have dissimilar imagery that creates pattern. That is pretty fascinating. And these are just some of the variety of cases that I've made with some of those ideas. And these are all coil built because coil building is slow and very soothing. It's healing, it's like knitting, it's an activity that can be wonderfully, the first coil built piece I did was after 9/11, and it just felt like the right thing to do. It's often, is it true that it's often done by women?
Yeah.
family awards, including Good Day Fellowships, Archie Gray Fellowships. You've done residencies at many places, including the Archie Gray and Gina Chen. exhibitions. You were in the 74th Scripps College Invitational on Narrative Ceramics, which is a picture work. That was the same year that we showed you here in Food as a Collaborative.
east side of the country. But yeah, this is the, I mean, as you see, this is a country that all, you know, all those like traditional buildings, and also there's like skyscraper right next to it. So yeah, when I came to America for the first time, the first thing that I noticed was, wow, sky can be big. Because you don't really get to see any skies in that country. Mm. And this is a country with lots of color, primary colors. My mom told me a story. She's Asian mom, so she put me in every single possible lessons you can name it. I even like took a lesson how to play Go. Like swimming lessons, like mathematics, science, arts. My mom plays violin, so she taught me how to play violin ever since I was 2 or 3. And then she of course put me in the art classes. So I remember going to like drawing, painting, little like whatever. And then my mom was so worried to that, that I don't use any of black or navy or brown. I only use this bright colors. So she was worried so much, right? But why would you? This is the color that I'm surrounded by every day. Mm-hmm. So this is the color that I think I can relate it to. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So this was actually the first time. I mean, when I heard about our show title, Sense of Place, I knew that it was about immigration, it's about the different generations living in America. For the first time, I studied about Korean immigration history in America. That was very fascinating. I was like, always like, why people get together in church? Why everybody has to be Christian? When I say I'm Catholic, everybody goes like, no, you have to be Christian. I met somebody who like gave me the whole paper full of what's the difference between Christian and Catholic. I'm like, why is so important? What I learned, that was the reason people can get together, still keep their culture and language, and be social in that group. That's why our Korean church was such a thing as an immigrant living in different countries. That's what I learned. But anyway, so I don't go to church. in our country, as you all know, most of you all know, we still has American Army came into our country, saving us, helping us, yeah, from getting invaded by other countries. So I remember growing up, this probably is like early 90s, every Sunday, I think it's like 11 a.m., Channel 2, there is a channel for specific for the American family. So on the Sunday, there's a Sesame Street for their children. And my mom figured it out. Didn't take that long. So she'll put me on this whole TV in front of the TV on Sunday morning and then force me to watch this. I hated it. I'm not a genius that I'll pick English right away just watching Sesame Street. Instead, I freaked out about the whole thing. These characters are crazy. I hate big birds. I can't stand bird feet. Like, gross me out. And there's a giant yellow bird. Like, you know. And then a bird, it has unibrows that I just could not connect to. Nor prairie dog doesn't have nose. It's freaky if you think of it. Nor all the stories that it's not based on our culture, right? It's all Western culture, but we had to force read it. It's a word, you know, everybody has to read it. Every children has to read it. It's tragic, right? If you think of it like the mermaid, Little Mermaid, if you think of it, felt like Korean art education, it just all boxed.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you ask me who I am. And then, like, my professor will come in, my Korean professor will come in, it was a wheel throwing 101 class. He's home over, I can tell clearly.
Oh.
He comes in and then throw a cylinder, one cylinder, and told me to make 50 mugs by next class. Yeah, I didn't go to bed for 3 days, but I made it. You know, I tried to make 50 mugs for the first time, you have to make maybe 70, and you'll have a good 50 mugs. Versus her, Carrie comes in, she gave us a block of clay, and say, go outside, get all those texture that you can have from the nature, and then make a sphere, or the box form. And each side has to have different theme. That was something different. She's basically asking us who I am, what do we like, what we're really into, and then making it into your own art. And I was like, oh, that's what I want to study more. So she knew that I was struggling in our school system. I will go talk to her. My English is so broken, I still have some accent. Sometimes whenever I get tired, I do have that, you know, speak English time. So one day she's like, she suggested, like, do you want to go study in America? Why don't you go do that? So I had to have my father's permission, which took me a while, but he did eventually, which I really appreciated. And then America has a lot of scholarship options as a minority student, if you really knock them to it. So I did it, and I got a scholarship. And then my dad's company also gave some scholarship. That was how I could come and study. So I went to Alfred. And this is actually my senior show from college. So it's like 9 foot tall column that I name a shrine. It's all wheeled around and has a little pole in the middle and step them up. So that was my work back in college. So I could not separate myself as a potter yet, but I knew I always have something with figurative works. And this is the first piece that I made in graduate school from UGA. You can still tell that I still have to be a potter somehow. But I'm grateful because I know how to throw 50 mugs. Now I can teach my student how to throw. One of the good things about grad school that I went UGA, Songbuyo and Ted Sope, they just let me be who I am. They gave me a lot of freedom. A lot of time, like a lot of my other friends, like, threatened me, like, if you go to grad school, everybody will, like, punch you here and there. They can really straight you out, but no, not at UGA. They just really let me who I am. And then one day Ted walked in and then he gave us the homework. Say, oh, we have this showcase and I want you guys to make work that can rate it, like movie rating. So PG-13 to X rated.
Huh.
So it started from left, the girl meeting the bunny, girl loving the bunny, girl choking the bunny, girl eat her head off, and calling another bunny. Before this work, I was making work that are very, like, quiet and naive, and color tone was very white, right? I just moved it. And I think a lot of my colleagues, like, why are you making all this, like, cutesy work, you know? And I'm like, I'm gonna show you that I can make work that I can make X-rated. So I show all of me, and I loved it. I was like, this is me. I have some sort of dark humor. I mean, I was always an Asian girl who always just, like, sit back and quiet, like, smiling and agree with everything. But that wasn't really me. I just didn't speak English well, that I could not really express who I am. Only way I could really do it is through my work. Yeah. in 2016, like one of my great friend, she normally go on to like search committee, so she gave me all those questions that she could possibly ask. That helped. I got me a job. But yeah. So I mainly, I mean, I did had an artist talk here not that long ago, so I didn't want to do the same thing. So I just briefly went on who I am, where I'm from, but I wanted to talk about the work I actually showed here this time. they mean. So for that work, one of the ceramic artists, Adam Chu, created a show, and he invited a couple artists, and then we had to pick the animal from the zodiac sign, and I'm a cow, so I picked my own sign, and then made a work. And that was the first time that I actually read how each animal become who goes first to second, the order wise. And I don't know if you read the story, you know, but briefly, if I talk about it, cow, you know, if you say, oh, I'm a year old cow, they all think that you're the working hard worker, set the goal, the stubborn, like, get to the goal, you know,
but last.
So cow was set the goal, I'm gonna go to the finish line. So he's like, I'm on it. So he was about to go, he swim all the way through the river or something and get to the shore. He was about to go to the finish line, and then of course the rat was riding on him full time. Cow didn't know, jump off of him and then finish the line for the first. So he become the first animal of the calendar. Yeah, did you know?
I didn't know that.
So I was like, yeah, people just see his cow, year of cow, as our worker stubborn. No. We're all like, what if I was a cow, I would be like raising upset. I would be like, is that the rat all time? Is it any of you are either of that? I made a piece about that. It's not about sign, it's about how I would be get so upset about the situation. So yeah, so that's why I picked the color and things, and then people think that it's not of time, it's about the people. And again, so then I was thinking about how we can all relate it to color, but each country has a different meaning of each color. So especially red. In China, red means football. Right? All of our good things. In Korea, red means death. That's not a good meaning, it's negative. So it called my red moment. So you can interpret your own way. As Beth talks about it, like as an artist, I feel like we should all talk about what's going on, like politically. You know, I mean, also personally, but like, we have a goal to talk about really, so like, what's going on in our society, right? And then I went to go see this show in Atlanta earlier this year. It was very impressive. It was talking about black rights, you know. And as an Asian, we also talk about our right as a minority, right? So that really got me to think about. So I created a work about this. So this is a girl bending over. We have a little cloud coming out of her chest. And then there's a white drips coming down from the sky. It was really funny because I was making this work in my school, at school, I think at college, in the studio. And I painted her black, so that was the original idea. And then since I'm in the academia, I was like, whoa, this can be very controversial. It can cause a lot of problems. So I painted her gray. I actually mixed black with tints of yellow and then made her glow gray. So it represented me and then my original idea. And obviously drops are made with old white porcelain. In America. Again, this is my newest piece, I literally one day I was like, well, if there's active sugar, what am I gonna do?
Thank you.
Beth, would you like to bring
up? Are we going to do a Q&A now? To give
a
brief
Q&A.
Chance to ask questions?
Okay.
Yeah.
We'll turn on the lights, maybe?
Or not? Do you all want lights or is this okay?
Turn on the lights so they can see you.
Sure.
Yeah.
Anyone has a question for Beth or Quinlan? Don't be shy. Another question, perhaps?
Yes.
Any?
Well, it's so wonderful to see, like, an artist at different stages in your work, and the juxtaposition of both your talks was so interesting. So I was wondering if you could reflect, because you put so much of your, like, there's so much in your work, but then you have this long with, like, what gets said, put together. Do you remember being her age and what you didn't know then that you kind of put together?
Well, I think early on I didn't think about putting anything else. Anybody else? Beth, did you talk about when you started the coiling?
I just barely mentioned it, but the first large coil base that I did was right after 9/11.
Oh, that's right. You did say that.
I just physically felt like that was the right thing to do, and you could hear something the coil, and it's just really slow.
Such a long history.
He does have a really long history. And then there's just the practical sense of I can't really wedge a big piece of clay like this or center a really big piece of clay. So if I want to work big, it's helpful to be able to coil build. And I coil build in pairs a lot, so I use a template so that I can get to about the same shape.
Audio is such a significant important person. That's right.
thank you all very much. You know, it's such a beautiful show, and I think in part you all have so much in common, and that you admire each other so much. So it makes it even richer and more meaningful for us.
Yes, thank you. Yeah, we feel very lucky to
we
have
do.
Both of you.
It's very special.
Yeah, very special show.
So many lines and ceramics reverberating together
yes.
at our gallery.
Yeah, we appreciate everyone's attendance as well. Yeah, and being such a wonderful, supportive audience. So we're going to end here. How about you all, everyone just, you know, mingle.
Make it informal.
Yeah, mingle. And
don't
then
leave without your questions
yes.
answered. How's that?
All right,
thank
you so much for coming.